Hello everyone, I'm Cody B, and I'm back with another Borderlands DLC review, going back to back with these. This time we're also going to be still hanging out with our boy Hammerlock in Borderlands 3 this time, with the Guns, Love, and Tentacles DLC. This was the second DLC for Borderlands 3, and this was also my first full playthrough of it, and I gotta say, it was quite the experience. It starts out with us getting an invitation to Hammerlock and Wainwright's wedding. They decided to tie the knot on a distant planet called Xylorgos, a frigid planet full of dangerous creatures and the giant corpse of a tentacle monster, thus the tentacles in Guns, Love, and Tentacles. We get a returning Vault Hunter from Borderlands 2 in the form of Gage and her robot Death Trap. She's been hired as a wedding planner, but things don't quite get off to the right foot. After helping Gage from the wreckage of her ship, she crash-landed, don't worry about it, we make our way to the hub location of this DLC, being the Lodge. Here we meet Hammerlock, along with a new character who is the owner of the Lodge, a man named Mancubus Bloodtooth, who is a bit of an odd man. He has a weird aura about him. We are told that Wainwright went into town to check on the wedding venue personally, so we head into town to find him. Upon entering the town, there is clearly something off with its inhabitants. Everyone seems to just be afflicted by some sort of curse. I actually really appreciate this, as almost every NPC in this area can be spoken to, having a special interaction with the player. It was just a very nice detail. So once we rendezvous with Wainwright, we end up stumbling onto a ritual being performed by a cult of some sort, the leaders seeming to be a man and a woman by the names of Vincent and Eleanor. We battle Vincent and discover something very interesting. Vincent's consciousness exists in a parasitic state attached to the ring that, once attached to the host, will turn them into Vincent. We discover this through the fact that the ring gets attached to Wainwright. We manage to get him back to the Lodge, which gives us a little bit of time to figure out how to rid Wainwright of this curse. The setup here is actually fantastic, and in fact the whole story that was told here was just very well done, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. There are some really cool and actually pretty mature things that were presented here. One thing that really stuck out to me was how Hammerlock and Wainwright separately express having similar anxieties about whether they are truly the right person for the other, and if they can truly make the other one happy. This is something that I'm sure will pass through everyone's mind in some capacity at some point when in a relationship, and it was really nice to see something like this expressed, and very well at that. The storytelling in general for this DLC was just fantastic, and a complete far cry from the base game of Borderlands 3, and I was quite honestly blown away by it. Now, I will say, it's not like some flawless magnum opus story of the ages or anything like that, but as far as the Borderlands series is concerned, it is probably the best storytelling I've experienced in this series outside of Tales of the Borderlands, which is still, bar none, the best storytelling in the entire series. And this even extends beyond the main missions into the side missions. Every single side mission was great in this DLC. None were grindy, and most had a pretty good story, especially the Cold Case side mission chain. I don't want to spoil those missions at all, so I just recommend you go play them. They are fantastic. My praise for this DLC continues onto the characters as well. Each character, whether they are old or new, is just fantastic. Let's start by talking a bit about Gage. She was definitely done correctly. I believe Gage could have very easily been a very annoying character, but she's not. Every time she speaks, I really enjoyed hearing what she had to say. The voice actress did a fantastic job portraying her, and I'm just kind of amazed that they managed to make a quirky, I'm not like other girls type character really good. Even in a side mission at the end of the DLC where Gage is pretty drunk, she still managed to be a very likable character that wasn't annoying. She was definitely my favorite character from this DLC. Hammerlock and Wainwright I'm going to kind of bunch into one. Even though the DLC is about them, they kind of take a backseat for the most part, as Wainwright spends most of the DLC battling the curse, and Hammerlock only sort of worryingly chimes in every so often, and outside of the relationship anxiety thing that I already mentioned, there isn't a ton more that they do, but they're still really good. The owner of the Lodge I mentioned earlier, Mancubus Bloodtooth, is a bit of a weird guy. At first I thought he was going to be a bad guy, but he turned out to be good in the end, and if not a little bit strange and maybe a bit evil, but he's more of a painlessly kill them while they sleep type of evil, so he's not that bad, and he does help us out, so I guess he's good. Another character that I enjoyed a ton was Bert. He is the focus of that side mission chain I mentioned earlier, so I won't get too far into him, but I will say that I really enjoyed his dialogue. He's a detective that is cursed with not being able to remember anything, so he's very interesting and I like that a lot. Iced is the last character that we meet who is a good guy. He's the leader of a hunting party and just has a really cool energy about him. He helps us track down a boss that we fight later in the DLC, and since I was playing as Flack, it felt very appropriate that they became friends, as they both enjoy the hunt and all that kind of stuff, so I liked his character as well. Moving on now into our villains, Eleanor and Vincent. They started off their lives before being all evil and stuff as doll scientists, who were madly in love. They were researching the ancient god of Githian, Githian being the giant tentacle monster. The body is dead, but the heart still beats. Vincent got consumed by the heart, and that turned into the ring thing, and thus they formed a cult around that. They were corrupted by the pursuit of immortality, and I think that's really cool, and they were just fairly compelling enemies, especially when you consider the limited time that you have in a DLC to develop a villain, so they were definitely serviceable. But I will say that the final battle with them was a little disappointing. It's not bad, it's just very easy and takes way too long as a very spongy boss. But it can be forgiven, of course. So as far as bosses are concerned in this DLC, they were all pretty good as well. Not a single one of them I didn't enjoy, and one thing I really did like was that each of them had actual mechanics that were enjoyable. But there is really mainly one boss that I want to put a spotlight on, being the Wendigo. I made a video a while back going over my top 10 favorite bosses in the Borderlands series. This was made before I played this DLC, obviously, but let me tell you, Wendigo would take number one on that list. This fight was just awesome. The Wendigo is my favorite folklore type cryptid thing, whatever you want to call it, so to fight one in the Borderlands series was just great. Plus the design of the boss was gruesome, the mechanics were fun, and I just love it. This was just such a treat to see in this DLC. So getting close to the end now, I want to discuss a few more things, being some gear that I found in this DLC. I likely didn't find every new gun in this DLC, and I'm not going to spend all the time finding them all at this current moment, but I did find two guns and a relic that I did very much enjoy. Let's start this off with the relic, the Pearl of Ineffable Knowledge. This is a guaranteed find from Claptrap, who will give it to you once you reach a certain point in the DLC. This thing is just a beast. It'll make your damage go through the roof, especially helpful on Mayhem 11, which is what I play on now, as it's just the best way to play the game. I really like the setup for this though, as in the beginning of the DLC, Gage sends Claptrap off to do some bogus mission to find it, just to get rid of him, as Hammerlock doesn't really want Claptrap to be there. But we get updates from Claptrap that are actually very enjoyable to listen to, and at the end it all culminates with us getting this relic, so I like it. So the first gun we'll talk about is the SF Force. It's a Malawan beam laser that has the special effect of dealing damage with both elements at the same time, and this thing is a beast if you have a good one. The one I have is decent. I got a better one that had a bad anoint, so I went back to refarm one, and that seriously took forever. I must have bad luck or something, as I was on this for so long and it just wasn't dropping. Even on Mayhem 10, I ended up getting this one to drop here with the decent anoint, so it's usable, but I will farm a better one eventually. But now, let's talk about the final weapon. We have the Soul Render. Bro, let me tell you about the Soul Render. This gun just slaps. Like, it amazed me. Its special effect is that it sends out these homing skulls that hit like a truck. I was not expecting it to be this good when I picked it up, but it has definitely jumped to my favorite assault rifle in the game, if not my favorite weapon in the entire game. This is just so much fun to use. So there we have it. The Guns, Love, and Tentacles DLC was a really big surprise to me. The story was well written and well executed. Every map and location is just absolutely gorgeous, which is honestly kind of just a given for the Borderlands series, but it still managed to wow me. And overall, I just had a fantastic time with this DLC. It gets an easy 10 out of 10. The first I have ever awarded since I began doing reviews of the Borderlands DLCs and other games, so definitely play this, it's fantastic. But with that, thank you for watching, I hope you enjoyed, and peace out.